I'm really delighted to be here and to say to Megan and also to Francis to thank the CERTAC and the TUC for maintaining a very strong line and not diluting their commitment to multiculturalism, despite the great attacks on it, which we'll hear about today during the course of today. The connections between what is happening to working people and the connection to what is happening to the whole agenda of multiculturalism is a critical one. The events in Norway in the summer were not just that cliche, a wake-up call, but they illustrated very clearly that the strategy that many were pursuing in the One Society, Many Cultures organisation, Unite Against Fascism, by trade unions, and so many organisations and community groups, that there was a strategic, and there is a strategic problem of racism, a strategic problem of Islamophobia across Europe, the far right not just exhibiting their power in daily violence against people, but in mainstreaming with the with governments right across the European Union. All of that agenda, of course, has been played out, but there needed to be perhaps an illustration for those who were not willing to listen. And many of you will remember the day that Breivik carried out this terrible atrocity. I'm sure you were watching in this 24-hour media world that we live in, how many commentators appeared on our television screens, including from the United States, explaining which bit of Al-Qaeda had caused this great atrocity in Norway. They identified actual people, really detailed information from think tanks right across the United States and Europe. And as time went on, the newsreader would say, yes, they've got somebody who's Norwegian and blonde. Is that still going to be Al-Qaeda? Of course it is. Yes, because Al-Qaeda has so many subtle and interesting ways of operating. And until the evidence was so clear that this was a far-right activist, until the evidence was so crystal clear, we were treated to this kind of, it's a Muslim, what's going to happen now? And I think this is a very important moment for all of us, because the tragedy itself, of course, intrinsically was a terrible thing. But it illustrated two things for us, and I know that Jean Lambert too will talk about these issues, because in Europe, what has been happening now for many years, but is reaching a very critical point, is that you have two types of far-right operating. And it's very convenient for the political commentators to say that it's one or the other. Violent extremism, of course, exists. And it exists in many forms. It exists the daily Islamophobia that people have to have, the unreported racial attacks. It exists in intimidation and all sorts of forms. But there is a much deeper strategic view of the far right, which we have been worrying about for many years, which now is reaching a point where it is almost difficult to push it back. And that is the reality of the far right in government. This is not some sort of cliche. This is a country by country state of affairs. And the left and trade unions and NGOs are fighting this. But it is a very, very tough battle. If you just pick any country, you see a version of far-right infiltration into government. For example, if you look at Hungary, Jobbik, the far-right extremists, who actually wear uniforms, the European Parliament, I don't know if you may have seen them, they actually wear their caps, scarves, and yes, boots. I've seen them in the lifts. They are extraordinary. But of course, they don't run Hungary. They have just shifted Hungary to the right. And if you're in the Roma population in Hungary, if you're a left-wing activist in Hungary, you understand that politics has changed forever. And it's changed forever
because the far right exerts influence on government, and they exert influence on the right-wing party, Fidesz, which is ruling that country with a two-thirds majority. That's what matters. When the Labour Party gets into power in Denmark, as it did, and I'm happy that it has, of course, its agenda is influenced by the perpetual Danish People's Party push to the right. So what it says about immigration, what it says about multiculturalism, is forever pushed to the right. When we have the presidential elections in France, the mainstream of the National Front is something which is extraordinary. If you read the local election results carefully, never mind all the sort of media blur, you will see the National Front taking votes not just from the traditional right-wing areas, but we will be taking votes from traditional left-wing voters. And you will see Marine Le Pen, who has denounced anti-Semitism for the moment and is going a very strong Islamophobic journey, you will see their popularity in the presidential elections. I promise you, because it's there in the electoral results and in the elections in France. And in Italy, you see a permanent change in the way all politicians behave from left to right because of the mainstreaming of the far right. So the message for us is the far right have to be fought, yes, on the streets, but they are morphing into different versions of the far right. We see it in the internet, we see it in the hatred of Breivik, but we also see it in the proxy movements of the EDL, which for some bizarre reason were able for month after month to convince journalists that they were some sort of multicultural far-right movement, or we have black people in the EDL. This went on for months, and of course the reason that everyone in this hall, we know what the EDL are, they're fascist thugs. But how long did it take for the penny to drop? How long did it take for people to understand the nature of proxy movements? How long does it take for people to understand the way that Islamophobia now has become the acceptable hatred, has become the mainstream hatred for many of these groups? And how long is it going to take for connections to be made between what Breivik did and what EDL did and the many connections that they have? So for us, the agenda right across Europe is a very simple one. We don't divide and rule. We understand that the far right will still exist in the extremist form in the grassroots. We know that that's going to happen. And we have to understand the far right exists in government right across Europe. Nearly all the 27 member states of the European Union have right-wing governments today. In an age of austerity and recession, people are afraid and they have moved to the right. And those right-wing governments are moving further to the right, partly because of the push from far-right extremism within those governments. That's the agenda we have to fight on the streets, in government, amongst our trade unions and NGOs. That's where we have to fight. And if anyone says to you, well, you know, and I've heard it day after day, multiculturalism, you know, we don't want to do that, that's a bit old-fashioned. Well, I'm really pleased that One Society of Many Cultures and United Against Fascism and all the various groups that have got together want to restate the message today. We have a strategic fight on our hands. We have a huge fight on our hands. Let's keep organised, let's get organised and fight the fight and stay together united.